happening, right? And I'm not going to get into all of the many different conspiracy theories. There's a lot of that out there all over the place. I'm talking about what the Bible is talking about. Merely limiting it to the prophetic ideas and imagery that's conveyed in the Bible. So let's go ahead and go back and refresh our memories, starting with chapter 4 of Daniel. Nebuchadnezzar, the king, says unto all the people, nations, and languages that dwell in all the earth. And see, there again is that it says all the earth, but remembering the territory that they would have seen as all their earth or their world, right? Peace be multiplied unto you. I thought it good to show the signs and wonders that the high God hath wrought toward me. How great are his signs and how mighty are his wonders. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and his dominion from generation to generation. Now here, remembering that Nebuchadnezzar was so impressed with Daniel's ability to provide him with an interpretation that he had for a short bit of time, even though he was a Babylonian king and a pagan, polytheism was his idea, you know, the multiple gods and the multiple idols. He was so impressed with Daniel, as we read in the previous chapter, that he sort of adopted or was very enthralled with, at least for a short period of time, the God of Daniel, right? And so now he is giving praise to the God, the Almighty, Most High God. And he goes on, I, Nebuchadnezzar, was at rest in mine house and flourishing in my palace, and I saw a dream which made me afraid, and thoughts on upon my bed and the visions of my head troubled me. Therefore I made a decree to bring in all the wise men of Babylon before me, that they might make known unto me the interpretation of the dream. Then came in the magicians and astrologers, Chaldeans and the soothsayers, and I told them the dream before them, but they did not make known unto me the interpretation thereof. But at last Daniel came in before me, whose name is Belteshazzar, according to the name of my God, remembering that the first thing they did with these Israelite young men, when they first retrieved them, they may have been adolescents, they brought them in, they gave them new names, and they started training them and teaching them in their schools, under their rule, and then additionally, they chose some selected Israelite boys, young men, to put into the magician schools that they were, the astrology schools and so forth. And Daniel and his three companions stood out. If you recall, they had favor with the Lord, and so they stood out. They were very accomplished. So now Nebuchadnezzar is recalling Daniel, and he states here that he had given him a name according to his God, his idols, because that's one of the first things that the enemy does. Want to change your name, take away your history. Remember, they wanted to feed them the food that the king was eating. They wanted to clothe them in the clothes that the king is more accustomed to. They changed their habits and their routine. This is what happens. You know, I don't want to imply that that's, you know, kind of the thing that happens in military, but that is one of the best examples. When you go to the military, you're no longer wearing civilian clothes. You're no longer going by your own schedule. You're going by the schedule of that military. You're dressing like them. You've got rules like them. You're eating in their, mess hall or whatever, cafeterias, and so forth. So you're doing things their way, in other words, right? So Nebuchadnezzar is kind of the forerunner of that concept, right? You come into his kingdom, and you're going to do things his way, and then he's going to change your name. So he even tried to make them bow down, remember, before his statue. And so serving their gods. serving his gods, the pagan gods. But he's reminding us here where Daniel received his name. And in whom is the spirit of the holy gods? And before him I told the dream, saying, O Belteshazzar, master of the magicians. Again, remember Daniel and his companions got favor. Daniel was the best because he had who? He had the Almighty God giving him the interpretation, blessing him with that ability. Master of the magicians, because I know that the spirit of the holy gods is in thee, and no secret troubleth thee, tell me the visions of my dream that I have seen and the interpretation thereof. Thus were the visions of mine head in my bed. I saw, behold, a tree in the midst of the earth, and the height thereof was great. The tree grew and was strong, and the height thereof reached unto heaven, and the sight thereof to the end of all the earth. The leaves thereof were fair, in other words, beautiful, and the fruit thereof was much or great, and in it was meat for all. So this tree was magnificent, not only in size, but in beauty and abundance of fruit, enough to feed a lot of people. And he says, for all. The beasts of the field had shadow under it. Great big tree. Our animals could relax under the shade of this tree, right? The fowls of the heaven dwelt in the boughs thereof, and all the flesh was fed of it. This is in this dream he's having, this is a magnificent tree here, right? Spreading out for all the earth and is tall to reach the heavens. I saw in the visions of my head upon my bed, and behold, a watcher, and a holy one came down from heaven. He cried aloud and said, thus, you down the tree, and cut off his branches, shake off his leaves, and scatter his fruit. Let the beasts get away from under it, and the fowls from its branches. Nevertheless, leave the stump of his roots in the earth, even with a band of iron and brass. Here's that iron and brass. In the tender grass of the field, and let it be wet with dew of heaven, and let his portion be with the beasts in the grass of the earth. Let his heart be changed from man's, and let a beast's heart be given unto him, and let seven times pass over him. This matter is by the decree of the watchers, and the demand by the word of the holy ones, to the intent that the living may know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men, and giveth it to whomsoever, the word says, he will, and setteth up over it the basis of men. Interesting word. In other words, God, the holy God, the Most High God, sets up kings. Remember, Daniel said this, sets up kings and kingdoms. And in this particular verse, verse 17, it says that God could choose even the basis of men. So God can use anybody, intelligent, foolish, wise, unwise, strong, weak. He can use anyone to accomplish his goal, to conform to his prophecy. And he goes on in verse 18. This dream I, King Nebuchadnezzar, have seen. Now, O Belteshazzar, declare the interpretation thereof. For as much as all the wise men of my kingdom are not able to make known to me the interpretation, but thou art able, for the spirit of the holy gods is in thee. Again, Nebuchadnezzar has recognized that Daniel is blessed by the Almighty God. Then Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, was astonished for 1 hour, In other words, he had to think about this, right? He's going to the Lord and seeking the Lord for guidance. And he says it. And he goes on, he says, he was astonished for 1 hour, and his thoughts troubled him. The king spake and said, Belteshazzar, let not the dream or the interpretation thereof trouble thee. Belteshazzar answered and said, my lord, the dream be to them that hate thee. The dream be to them that hate thee, and the interpretation thereof to thine enemies. Now he's laying it out. The tree that you saw, which grew and was strong, whose height reached unto the heaven, and the sight thereof to all the earth, whose leaves were fair, and the fruit thereof much, and in it was meat for all, under the tree the beasts of the field dwelt, and under whose branch and upon whose branches the fowls of the heaven had their habitation. It is thou, O king. So the tree is Nebuchadnezzar. And behold, thou art grown and become strong. Thy greatness is grown and reaches unto heaven, and thy dominion to the end of the earth, just as his dream depicted the tree, right? And whereas the king saw a watcher and a holy one coming down from heaven and saying, hew the tree down and destroy it, yet leave the stump of the roots thereof in the earth, even with a band of iron and brass in the tender grass of the field, and let it be wet with dew of heaven, and let his portion be with the beasts of the field till seven times pass over him. This is the interpretation, O king, and this is the decree of the Most High, which has come upon my lord. In other words, Daniel is talking about him. Come upon you, Nebuchadnezzar, that they shall drive thee from men. Who is the they? Thinking about the they. They shall drive thee from men, and thy dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. And they shall make thee to eat grass as oxen, and they shall wet thee with dew of heaven. And seven times, remember, times. I promised we would be talking about these measurements. What is times? In prophecy, recall we talked about times, time and half a times, and when we were looking in Revelation, right? And so the times is a year. And so this indicates this 7 years. So he goes on. Again, in the middle of the 25th verse. And seven times shall pass over thee, till thou know that the Most High rules in the kingdom of men, and giveth it to whomsoever he will. So if you are familiar with this vision, you know that Nebuchadnezzar was, this was the time when he was kind of seen as, you know, having lost his mind, right? And whereas they commanded to leave the stump of the tree roots, the kingdom shall be sure unto thee after that thou shalt have known that the heavens do rule. So God always makes his point, right? He always makes his point. And that's why I say his prophecies and his word is so accurate, because we're beginning to see how this is being carried out in Nebuchadnezzar's experience. Wherefore, O king, let my counsel be acceptable unto thee, and break off thy sins by righteousness, and thine iniquities by showing mercy to the poor, if it may be a lengthening of thy tranquility. All this came upon the king Nebuchadnezzar. And at the end of 12 months, so with some quickness, right? At the end of 12 months, he walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. The king spake and said, is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of, for the house, the kingdom of, by whose power? By the might of my power. Nebuchadnezzar is claiming this as his, being boastful, right? And this is an indication to us as